Internet, welcome to episode 276 of the Assorted Calibers podcast, the Second Amendment podcast. There's a little bit for everyone. I'm Weer'd, and tonight I am joined by the greatest hostess in the entire world. You know it. I know it. Does she know it?
No.
She may not know it. No. No, she does not know it. Erin Paulette. How are you doing, Erin?
Yeah, I have something to say, but it actually isn't about me, and it kind of leads into the main topic. So, I'm just going to say pass, and
okay.
I'm going to ask, how are you doing, Weer'd?
I'm doing okay. I'm okay. My daughter started feeling crappy on Sunday night and woke up and was just, I knew she was gonna stay home from school, and it just adds an extra level of complexity to the day where I'm cobbling together the show and reviewing everything and getting the segments all set up, and also grocery shopping day, and making an extra mouth to feed in the middle of the day. And I have just been running around. The proverbial one-armed paper hanger has been me today, and I'm happy to be peacefully seated here with my daughter asleep and my wife doing whatever she's gonna do. She don't care. And here I am with the lovely Erin Paulette.
You can flatter me all you like, I'm still not gonna sleep with you.
Well, that's okay. Weer'd Beer doesn't sleep, he waits.
Creepy.
No, I just don't sleep. I was up late doing handgun radio. I think it's gonna be a good show.
I mean, it like last Thursday when I was up, well, my usual time at like 2 a.m.
By the way, thank
and
you.
I noticed that it was like a movie track night, and you're still there.
Mm-hmm.
And so I actually logged on to Discord and I said, guys, let Weer'd Beer go to bed. He's got to be up in 3 hours.
Yes. And I was up in 3 hours. I am running on 3 hours of sleep.
Why do you do that?
Because I can. It seems like a good idea at the time. I experienced no regret.
Yeah, I don't buy that. I think you regret it immensely when you get up. You're just stubborn and don't want to admit it.
I mean, I was also a heavy drinking college student, so that if you go to bed completely sideways drunk, you may sleep for 6 to 8 hours, but it adds up to 3. So I may have also gotten the groove of this is just the trauma of waking up is just the thrill of the hunt. But I don't know. That's my Weer'd pathology.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you can get away with that in your 20s and maybe some into your 30s, but you're well into your 40s now. That's not healthy. That's not sustainable.
Well, then, tomorrow night, I will be fast asleep by 8:30.
All right.
I will be just in bed, face down, and just like, yep, nope, not even going to read a book. Just going to climb in, throw the covers over my head, and that's going to be the end of that story. Because the cool thing is that while you cannot gain a sleep surplus, you can pay back a sleep deficit.
Okay.
And I don't know if it works that for other people, but it's one of those, like, I can... It for me in the past, especially when I used to go out to sea, I have absolutely done the, well, you know what, I slept only 4 hours the last two nights. If I sleep 16 hours tomorrow, I'll be all better. And that's how it works.
And men wonder why women live longer than they do.
Oh, there's plenty of reasons for that. I love those memes of the, this is why women live longer than men. and it shows a bunch of men doing some absolutely stupid things that will that are horribly dangerous and have very minimal benefit. We'll be talking about that later too.
So you have said before, and I agree because I'm just as guilty about this, that we don't look ahead often enough so that when a podcast drops, we are topical for the day. And so by the time our listeners hear this, the day will have passed because the day's already passed. Mm-hmm. Yesterday, Sunday, the 19th of November, was International Men's Day. And in today's world, men are constantly told that they're toxic and worthless, except as a source of labor and money. And I want all of our male listeners to know that I don't hold that. I love and value all of you for who you are, not for what you think you must be. You're more than a wallet. You are fathers, sons, brothers, and husbands, and the world needs you for you, not just for the labor you provide. As the kids say, you have worth, kings. I want you all to become and continue to be the best men possible. And to do that, you need to stay alive. Please don't give in to despair. Men are the vast majority of suicides. And while all suicides are tragic, the fact that you are such a disproportionate number says that your emotional needs aren't being met. And there's very little that I can do, but I want you to know that I'm here to support you. And if you need help or just want to be vulnerable, I will listen and help as best I can and not judge you.
Absolutely well said. I mean, I have nothing to add. I could go on to long-winded rants about, you know, depiction of men in pop culture and things like that. The standard commercial with the wife, I know everything, and the man, oh, I ate my shoes.
Yeah.
So
I mean, I realize this is often seen as a controversial topic, and it really shouldn't. And people look at me, it's like, Aaron, you're transgender. Why do you say that? It's like, but why wouldn't I be? I mean, okay, Weer'd, Beard, you are my friend. You are a cis male. Mm-hmm. You enjoy being a cis male. That's wonderful. I support you, and I want you to stay alive. And, you know, it's not that I want to convert everyone. That would be ridiculous. You know, it's for exactly the same reason that I don't want to arm everyone. There are some people who shouldn't be armed for whatever reason. And not everyone should be a woman.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to support people for being themselves. It just seems like a logical extrapolation of who I am. And be comfortable in your skin and don't let society tell you that you don't have worth, because we need all people. So I know that culture and entertainment portrays men as either toxic predators or useless buffoons. And I can't do anything about that. But I know that you're more, and I see you for being more, and I appreciate you for being more. So
correct. And for the men out there, you are the man that you are, and don't worry too much about that, because here I am on the, yes, I am a cis man. I am very proud to be one. I am very happy in my own skin. And I also identify as a housewife. Anybody asks, I will say housewife and domestic goddess.
And I thought you were going to say kitchen bitch, but okay.
I mean, I also identify as that as well. And actually, we had I cooked salmon for dinner tonight, and my wife always laughs about the fact my mother-in-law is not the greatest cook in the world, and she is both not particularly varied and skilled in that, and also horribly nervous about foodborne pathogens. So therefore all food must be abjectly murdered and strangled in its crib. And so for her, all fish tastes like cat food. And so like the suddenly when I'm cooking seafood, she'd be like, oh, you're cooking seafood. Ooh, gross. And then it comes out and goes, oh, wait, I actually loved that. That was really good. And I'm like, yeah, this is also the same woman of the, I had just gotten off a boat and she was over at my parents' house for dinner, and I had just killed two monkfish like 3 hours before, and I was skinning and preparing the meat for it. I'd never had them before, and we totally screwed up cooking them. But they're very, very mild fish. If you ever get a chance to eat monkfish, it is wonderful. It is one of the easiest fish to cook because it's very, very difficult to overcook it. It's got a very, very firm texture to it, but it is extremely mild, so make sure you season it. But yeah, I was preparing it, and at one point she looked over and goes, you know, as I've got like fish slime all over my hands as I'm cutting these fish up, she's like, why doesn't it smell fishy? I'm like, because it's not rotten. These monkfish were very displeased of what I was doing to them about 3 hours ago. So yeah, but she was saying like, oh my God, that was such a good meal. And I love the fact that you've done all that. And I am so lucky to have someone like this who is taking care of me, because again, she is the primary breadwinner. And if it wasn't for me supporting her, she would not be able to be pushing herself as hard as she is to do the work that she is doing. And it works out wonderfully for all of us here. So again, you are the man that you are. So you could be the manly man with the guns and the knives, and I'm protecting the house and I'm going to be protecting everybody, but you can also be the French maid in the apron pushing a vacuum around. It's a Dyson, though. It's a powerful vacuum. It's a manly vacuum.
So I had this wonderful pivot. You know, we talked about suicide, and then we were going to talk about the first main topic about the gun death lie that the Milwaukee paper discovered. And then we went into the weeds involving you cooking fish and vacuuming as a French maid. And I have no idea how you're going to save this in the edit, if that's even possible.
That's the best way to save it, is we don't need to edit. You could tell the whole world how much I ruined your master plan. And we can all imagine how much better it would be if I had stepped on your wonderful plan. So yes, speaking of that, actually, I think you were the one that sent me this article, weren't you?
I did. Yeah. This is a Bearing Arms article written by friend of the show, Tom Knighton.
Mm-hmm.
And the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel was talking about gun deaths in Wisconsin and their increase. And they discovered, to very few people's shock, but apparently theirs, that suicides make up more than 2/3 of all gun deaths in Wisconsin. And so that was going to be the pivot. You know, men commit suicide. Most of them, you know, use a firearm to commit suicide. And according to this, that the majority of gun deaths are by firearm. And I mean, that does make sense, because if you want to kill yourself, you're not going to do it in a way that causes you to suffer, and you're probably going to want to do it in a way that guarantees success. It's very morbid to talk about, but what I'm getting at is I understand the cold calculations involved.
We also need to add in the 100% cultural thing. How many times have you seen someone put the finger gun to their head during a slow meeting or a boring class, or getting lectured by somebody, you know, on just the serendipitous, ugh, if I could just end it right now statement. So it's also really in the American culture that this is, you know, what goes on. And, you know, same idea when you look at, Japanese culture. There were some pretty prominent cases of seppuku in the 90s. In Japan. I think that was the last documented case, but think about how long that ancient tradition went on for that to be a choice of someone to end their own life. There is also a cultural aspect to it, and we see the firearm for its effectiveness, and it's available. So I don't fault the gun. I regret the choice of the person who chooses to end their life. Suicide's a tough one to talk about. But
the point that I'm making here is, this is something that we have, and I don't just mean Weer'd and I, but I mean firearm advocates in general, when people talk about the rise of gun deaths and they start bringing out these statistics, one of the first things I say, one of the first thing Weer'd says, and I hope one of the first questions you ask is, okay, how many of those are suicides? Mm-hmm. Because it's not a gotcha. It's not an immediate win, but the case can be argued that people who are having suicidal thoughts, who have suicidal ideation, if you remove the gun, you may save some. I will grant you that, because a lot of the appeal of a firearm suicide is, I've got it right there, I can do it before I think through things, it's done. But there are a lot of people who are just so committed to this that if you remove the firearm, they will find other ways. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned Japan. Japan is a fantastic example of that, because Japanese firearm ownership is so restricted that their Olympic shooting team cannot shoot in Japan. They have to go out of the country in order to practice. And yet they have a massive suicide rate. So simply removing the firearm will not, in any real sense, reduce suicide deaths. It'll simply reduce suicide firearm deaths.
Yeah. Furthermore, also to go on the statistics that I've talked about many, many times when dealing with this, I mean, essentially sleight of hand is really what's going on here. And I'll talk about that a little bit more in a bit. But when you look at international suicide rates, you will see that the United States is smack dab in the middle. And the outliers are a bit freaky deaky, because you've got like a whole ton of countries that have no suicide at all. And it's one of those, you think so? I'm pretty sure that's not true. But overall, once you get towards the middle of the list, you're getting at least relatively comparable numbers, whether it be comparably accurate or comparably inaccurate. But the United States is really right in the middle of the pack. And so therefore, there are countries that have much, much higher suicide rates than us. And there are countries that have much, much lower suicide rates than us. And none of those countries have our gun ownership rate. And so clearly it's not the guns. There are other factors that factor into this, and I'm not going to go deep into the weeds on a lot of those factors. There's lots of papers written by people far smarter than me about some of the factors that are going on, and demographics that have high amounts of suicide and demographics that don't, and what reasons there might be. But I will actually say I've said the word enough times that I need to shout this out. I actually had to look it up while Aaron was talking, because it's really not in the zeitgeist, and we need to change that. Is that in the United States, there is a suicide crisis line that has been set up as an emergency line. So like we all know, we dial 911 in the case of emergency. I've done it a ton of times myself. But if that emergency is not something that needs a first responder, does not need police and fire or medics, 988 will connect you with a crisis counselor anywhere in the United States. Just 988, just like you're doing 911 or 311, 988 is the number to do. And we need to talk about this more. And it's the fact that I had to look it up. It shows exactly how shameful that is, that everybody should be knowing this, because there's always somebody nearby. Just like you can always call the police, the fire, the medics by dialing 911, and they will get you the help you need. This is also another tool that you have. One thing I did want to say about the real thing that I dislike about the term gun death overall is, number one, it was outlined very, very nicely in Tom's article, is the fact that it's a huge portion of suicides. And if we can work to reduce suicides, we will lower the gun death rate astronomically within the United States, which is a good thing and a wonderful thing. Everyone is striving to do that. You know, the anti-gun people will sometimes portray us as being indifferent to gun deaths, and we're not. Just our solutions are not the same as theirs. Our solutions may actually work, unlike theirs. But the big thing is that the reason why the Milwaukee Journal is discovering this is because gun deaths are being packaged up in statistics like this by anti-gun groups, by people who are pushing gun control, and by the realization that the vast majority of these gun deaths are suicide. The idea that you're using it to push a magazine ban, that you're using it to push a ban on semi-automatic rifles, that you're using this to push mandatory training on handguns, that you're using this to push gun-free zones, that you're using this to push universal background checks. None of these things affect suicide. Someone who ends their life with a firearm, it's a firearm they own. It's a firearm that they've already got. It's probably a firearm they've had for a long period of time. It may be the firearm that, you know, it's the only one they have. I've known, unfortunately, people who've taken their life with a 22 carbine that they probably have had since they were a kid. And so the idea that we can ban certain powerful guns to reduce this gun death rate, or we can do magazine capacity or background, all these things have zero effect on suicide. There are absolutely things that we can do. I mentioned letting people know about the hotline, letting people know the call, having, you know, friend networks, having groups like Hold My Guns, where you could go into a gun shop and say, I'm going through a rough patch right now. Can I give you my guns and have you just hold on to them for right now, and I'll come back for them later when things are better? There's all sorts of things that you can do, but the people that are cooking up this number are cooking it up specifically to push an agenda that will have no effect on the number by its very nature. And then furthermore, Aaron, you mentioned, when you see a gun death number, the first thing, you know, anybody who's got critical thinking should ask is, all right, how much of that is are self-inflicted? Furthermore, look at it going, how much of that is a percentage of other violent crimes? Because that's also the big thing. My back when I was a steady blogger before I switched over to podcast being my muse, one thing I always had going on weirdworld.com, and you can, there's a tab in the corner of the page that you can click that says gun death. And I created a thing I called the gun death files, which was people would send me news stories where people had died by means other than firearms. And I would use that as a way to point out the fact that when you see these gun deaths, it's not factoring in the person who got stabbed, the person who got blown up, the person who got hit by a car, that there are always other means to do violence or tragic deaths or accidents that aren't firearms. And by the way that the anti-gun people package this gun death number, it implies that it's not gun death, as they say, but safety in general. And if we can reduce gun death numbers, we will get much lower numbers in total. But in fact, what if the gun death numbers are extremely low, but the stabbing deaths are extremely high? Well, is that better or worse? Shouldn't we just care about how safe are our streets? How safe are our people? How many families are being torn apart by violence, and not worry mm-hmm. about so much about the specific tool being used? And the only reason why we are is not because of anything about the gun. There's nothing that significant about it. Again, the United States is right in the middle of all these statistics. We're not the safest. We're one of the safest countries in the world. Of the safest countries in the world, we're not really in the top 10, but we're pretty high up there. But most of the countries are way more dangerous than us, and yet we've got all these guns. It's not a safety factor. It's so implying that, oh, the United States has an extremely high gun death rate, so long as you subtract all the other countries that have a higher gun death rate, is implying that we're insanely dangerous, and we're really not. And so, again, this is all sleight of hand. And I always like to shine a light on that, because this is really one of the tools used by the anti-gun agenda to paint a narrative that is not true by fixating on these gun death numbers and all the different tricks that they play with it. So now, continuing on the lines of ghoulish and scummy reporting, we have another story from Bearing Arms. And yeah, this is about the Washington Post. I've been talking a lot, Aaron. Do you want to cover this?
Nope.
Okay. Well, it appears that the Washington Post has released an article. I assume it's only online. Of course, they put everything behind a paywall, so I haven't actually seen this article. But they have been publishing crime scene photos. Specifically crime scene photos from shootings where an AR-15 was used. And their statement behind this, and again, this is very, very ghoulish in the fact that, you know, even Sandy Phillips was contacted. Of course, Sandy Phillips worked with the Brady campaign, may still technically be working with the Brady campaign, though not in as official a capacity, who lost her daughter in the Aurora, Colorado shooting, which was, gosh, how many years ago? All of these events are extremely old shootings, you know, at least months to years old. So this is not breaking news, but the idea is that they are trying to show them to shock people at the damage done by an AR-15. And I will say, as someone who has watched many of these live streams and security camera footage of these shooters whenever I can to study it and all of that, and someone who is a bit of a nerd when it comes to terminal ballistics and all that, I note that, AR-15s are not particularly special. If anything, they are special in the fact that they're kind of at the bare minimum, especially in the 5.56 category of what can be an effective firearm for personal defense and all of that. I happen to be someone whose go-to social rifles are all in 308. That's a caliber that I particularly like for many reasons. And as people point out with the shock and the horror of AR-15s, one person always pointed out, well, whatever you do, don't tell them Googling shotguns. Because if you've ever actually Massayoub, one of his stress fire books, I think it's Stress Fire 2, is all on combat shotgun. And they're black and white, but he's got plates in the middle that are all photographs. And a lot of them are of shotgun shootings. And, they can be very, very horrific. I'm not going to get too macabre on it, but oh my God. The amount of damage, there's that Clint Smith quote, you know, the quote, I don't need to say it to have to bleep it out and make myself more work. But, to paraphrase, a shotgun with the right load at the right range will physically remove a chunk of sugar off of your opponent and throw that sugar on the floor. And yeah, so it's ghoulish. It's really ignorant, because it all seems like it's written by, like gun control, by people who know absolutely nothing about firearms, but are speaking from a level of authority for reasons.
Well, what makes it worse, I mean, not that it's good by any means, but what makes it worse is that one of the people contacted, and therefore presumably one of the people whose murdered family member was going to have their picture shown, is the mother of a child victim from Uvalde. Mm-hmm. And so that's just grotesque on another level.
Oh, yeah. And then there was also... on one of the recent episodes of Cam and Company, he had now I'm drawing a blank on his name. I feel so bad. Brian Petty on, and he lost his daughter in Parkland, and he wasn't even contacted. He heard about it through his friendships, actually through Kimberly Garcia was actually the one that reached out to him and let him know that this was that this was going on. And I mean, what's worse about this too is that all these people are being let know that the Washington Post is going to publish graphic images of dead people from, and they're letting people know that they're going to be from Uvalde, from the Aurora, Colorado shooting, from from Parkland, and I don't know if anyone's doing Sandy Hook, if they're that ghoulish as well, but if they're doing Uvalde, then why not Sandy Hook?
But the point being here is that they aren't asking permission. Mm-hmm. They're simply saying, hey, we're doing this with the unspoken, you can't stop us.
And what they're also doing is they're leaving it up to essentially the family to decide, do we want to look at this to confirm or deny that our lost loved one is one of the people used? Or do you just sit back and just not know? And like, that's a really horrible dilemma to put someone in, is that these, you know, Kimberly Garcia was contacted and let know that they were going to be publishing pictures from the massacre where her daughter was killed, but not whether or not they're specifically posting pictures of her daughter. For all I know, these people don't even know who the people are in the pictures. And honestly speaking, would not surprise me if they don't care, because this is an agenda and this is ghoulish. You know, there's no education to this. This is what I'm always talking about with gun control, which is gun control's always being pushed in the wake of a tragedy. And it's always being pushed in the wake of a tragedy because if there is nothing in the news right now, and at the time of us recording this, and hopefully it's the same as you guys are hearing this, there is nothing major in the news right now as far as mass shootings go. And therefore, there's nobody pushing gun control on a legislative level, because it's just not going to go anywhere unless people are so upset that they're losing their common senses, that this is not going to work. This is not going to help anybody. And they're essentially trying to create that trauma so that they can demand and say that, oh, if you oppose banning assault weapons, then you're fine with these dead kids. And
you know, I'm not even sure if they thought that far ahead. They might have, but it might just be, this is ghoulish and grotesque, but it'll get clicks because people are drawn to that, this sort of thing. It's why people slow down and stare at car wrecks on the interstate.
I hadn't even gone there, because that's actually even worse, is they're cheapening these people's lives no matter what, and to cheapen it down to clicks, which absolutely is a real thing and not a stretch of the imagination at all, is ghoulish is the word that just keeps coming to my mind.
Yep, ghoulish and grotesque.
Yeah, so yeah, these guys are jerks. This is not great, and they're not being educational. They are not it's not even like they're, you know, it's, it was, you know, reported on many of this is the, oh, the, you know, when it comes to what the FBI considers a mass shooting, the vast majority of those handguns are the weapon of choice used. And it's not like they are showing handgun deaths and noting that handguns are considerably less dramatic in terminal ballistics than rifles, and somehow using that as a political talking point. Of course, they're not going to do that because the people that want to ban your AR-15 also want to ban your Glock, also want to ban your revolver. This is, you know, they're just, it's just what do they think they've got the best shot at right now? It's ghoulish. It's disrespectful. Again, you know, Parkland was years ago, and to inform people that, you know, your loved one who's been dead in the ground for years is we're going to unearth them in the digital sense by potentially posting pictures of their lifeless body for clicks, for an agenda. It's not right. It's not good, and shame on them. All right. Well, I'm grumpy from that. Let's move into something a little bit lighter. I think everyone could stand to have something a little bit lighter. And I mentioned last week that we've got more of Aaron and Annette. So Aaron continues her interview with Annette Evans from On Her Own. And this time Annette gives some useful advice that we could all use.
Oh, let's talk about one of the things that makes On Her Own unique, I think, is how inclusive it is.
Well, that sounds really interesting. Go on.
Yeah. On Her Own, one of the things that I was really aiming for in its creation was to be really, really inclusive and to be really focused on meeting people where they are. So much of the self-defense world and even the personal advice world and life advice world want people, they want people to be a certain person so that they can get help. So we see this in the self-defense world with things like, well, just don't go to that concert because you can't carry your gun. And to me, that's not realistic. That's not how we live life. That's not how we should live life. We should go to concerts because they're fun and then figure out a way to make them as safe as possible for us. Maybe a little bit more specific to the women's world. And this is true for men too, but we are in the age of dating apps and hookup apps, right?
Mm-hmm.
Tinder's a thing, or whatever app of your choice is, which means we are meeting people from the internet potentially for the express purpose of having casual sex with them. And there are a lot of people who in the self-defense world who say, don't do that. And we can name the litany of things that go wrong when you invite strangers from the internet into your intimate spaces. But again, I don't know that it's helpful and inclusive to tell people don't do that, because people want to do that. We can educate them about the ways in which there are dangers there that they might not know about. We can tell them this is the safest way to do the thing you want to do. Maybe by doing that, we teach them, they decide on their own, oh, this is a bad idea, I don't want to do it.
Right. Well, you can be absolutely safe if you never leave your house, but is that really living? You know, there is a time where you have to give up some safety in order to have quality of life. I mean, you know, prisoners in jail in solitary confinement are about as safe as you can make them, but they certainly aren't having an enriched life experience. So yet you do have to take risks. There's a reason that freedom is dangerous. And so it sounds like you are teaching women that it shouldn't be safety over everything else. Here's how you can be safe while still having a fulfilling life.
That's my goal. I don't think it's good for any of us to lock ourselves into our homes. I also don't think it's a good way to reach people who should be safe, because everybody deserves to be safe. And we don't get there by telling them, well, you can't do the thing that you love. We don't get there by telling them, well, if you don't do X, you can't be safe. Why would anybody listen to us if that's our starting position? You know, if my starting position is, well, you're dumb and this is why, this is what you should do instead. That's a hard one to bring people into the fold with. When instead I can say, hey, I know this is a thing you like to do. Let me tell you about problems that might come from them that you might not know about. And let me tell you about ways you can be safer while you do them. I want people to live the lives that make the most sense for them. I want to acknowledge that we're not all perfect, that we're not all going to make the best decisions all the time. John Farnham has a kind of famous rule about avoiding stupid people, stupid places, stupid times, and you'll probably be safe. How many of you have stupid friends who like to do stupid things that get us in stupid trouble? Probably most of us, if we're being completely honest, if not right now, at some point in our lives, we had that friend who was always getting us in trouble. Are you saying break up with those friends and never see them again? I don't know. And then stupid places and stupid times. How many of you have been out and about in the witching hours after going to a concert or even after hanging out with a friend or seeing a movie and you decide to hit a bar late or you're in Denny's at 2 o'clock in the morning? A lot of people would say that's a stupid place at a stupid time. How many of us have done that in college?
No, I think that's Waffle House.
That's true. You're further south than me. Up here, it would be Denny's. We don't have that many Waffle Houses. Waffle House might be more dangerous than Denny's. I think the joke that I heard is Denny's is Waffle House for people who can't fight.
Yes, that's exactly the point.
I don't think we actually help people be safer by telling them not to do the thing.
Mm-hmm. So is On Her Own a one-woman show at this point, or do you have other people that are helping you?
It is almost entirely me right now. I've got a few folks to bounce ideas off of. I actually met a lovely woman at the Liberal Gun Club national meeting who wants to help me out with some of the things I'm creating. And I collaborate with Carl Casarda in Range TV to produce video content. Which is to say, Carl very generously does all my video editing and gives me his platform to say things about guns and self-defense and my favorite topic, which is the entire world of self-defense tools that are created and marketed for women.
You mean Shrink-It and Pink-It?
Shrink-It and Pink-It is part of it, but also stuff like, I don't know, those cat keychains. You've seen those, right?
Yes, I have.
Uh-huh. Let's see. How many times have you been told that you can use tampons for gunshot wounds?
Oh dear. Yes.
So that's some of the content that we cover. I have an on and off series where I look at these products and go, well, do they work? Do they not work? Why? What do we need to look at for products like this? And put them through some testing, if possible. One of my favorite episodes is when I looked at the Flashbang bra holster.
I remember that from Beauty and the Blast, I think.
I've used it back then, but I did Lethal Lace when I was Beauty Behind the Blast.
That's what I
was thinking
of.
That did not turn out so well.
Yes. Yeah, you ripped that one a new one.
But I did a Flashbang, which is another, you know, holster for women, primarily because most men I know who present as male don't wear bras. They can, but they don't. So it's a holster that attaches to the bra and holds the gun sort of between and under the breast. It's got a slightly different draw pattern. And there's a lot of people who go, well, they're dangerous and they'll never work. And what an awful idea. I can't believe they're still selling these. And full disclosure, I know the owner, the inventor, and I know that, you know, we're friends. I like her a lot. Lisa's fantastic. So I wanted to test it in a really tough environment, though, that wasn't just influenced by how I felt about it. So I took a Flashbang holster to Craig Douglas's Extreme Close Quarters Concepts class, which is his flagship class and one of the top classes in the industry on dealing with a gun inside of grabbing range of another person. Like, how do you get to your gun? How do you use your gun in that kind of circumstance? So I did it with a gun and a flashbang and put it on video, and it's on in-range TV.
So for those of us who may not be able to go to the video, what's the 30-second conclusion that you got from testing it?
It is safe, it is effective, and you can get to it in a fight. And you can draw quickly, even if you're not inside the entangled fight, like if you have time and distance.
Does it require a lot of training to get familiar with that?
I actually cover how to use it in the video if you do have, if you're interested and have the opportunity. It's a relatively straightforward draw that's based a lot on how shoulder holsters work. It's the hardest part for most people is figuring out how to wear it and conceal it. It doesn't require very large breasts, but it does require being thoughtful about the size of the gun compared to the size of your torso and the fit of your bra.
I would also imagine clothing that is very tight around the belly would also not work well. Not only would it showcase the bulge of the gun, but also make it harder to lift the shirt in order to get to the gun.
It sits sort of in that spot that for some women is kind of a tent from, you know, the front of the breast to the belly. So for some people, they can do slightly tighter clothing with it. Not everybody. Depends on your particular proportions and gun and everything else. But for the draw, it's just like any other draw somewhere around the waistline. Is you do need to be able to get that cover garment out of the way.
Interesting.
Although I have access to flashbang, not in a very non-traditional way through the neckline. Wasn't ideal, but it is doable. I wouldn't use that as a first choice.
Do you continue to review other products like the Lethal Lace and the Flashbang?
I most certainly do. I'm actually going down, I think, we're preliminarily planning for me to go down to New Mexico in January and film some new content for InRange. And I would love to do new, you know, women's self-defense products I haven't yet taken a look at. There's these, like, self-defense rings. I think I was talking about them at conference that look hideously awful, but I don't want to spend, like, $200 or $300 on them. The other thing I've done is if people have stuff and they want to like send it to me, I'll either send it back or they can use me as a way to get rid of it. And I'll use those for content too.
But Annette, why don't those plastic cat ear keychain finger things work?
Because they'll deglove you and they won't actually create extra impact. They're just, just bad.
I knew they were bad. I didn't know about the degloving. Ugh.
Yeah, because they're generally made of really, like, they're thin. So those rings will slide onto your fingers, and they're thin enough to cut and deglove, especially because they don't fit snugly. Even if they did, it would still be pretty bad.
Yeah.
They also aren't dimensioned properly to support the palm correctly like you would get in a pair of brass knuckles. So, like, you'll end up, like, causing pain in your palm as the bottom edge of that cat face kind of drives into your palm when you try to hit someone. And all that. And so here's the thing about force multipliers, which that is, if you multiply anything by zero, it's still zero.
That's good. Did you come up with that?
I don't know if I came up with it, but I use it.
that's really good. I'm going to start quoting you on that.
Any of these like striking like coubetons and cat keychains and even brass knuckles and stuff, they rely on the fact that you're going to hit somebody, which means you have to actually hit them. And you have to hit them with some amount of power in a place that will make a difference. So I don't know how many fist fights you've been in, whether in training or for real, or how many you've seen. And it's like kind of hard to do that, especially with reduced strength.
I assume you're talking about the difference in musculature between men and women?
Yup.
Okay. I mean, that doesn't even get into, you know, the height difference, which means a reach difference. And then, of course, the weight difference.
Yep. Yeah. If you don't have weight behind that punch, it's hard to build up enough power. Like, if you watch UFC, I actually went at some point and looked up the UFC stats for knockouts at different weight classes for men and women. And there are only a handful of women in the UFC who have knockout power and have actually knocked somebody out in a fight. Not a technical knockout, like actually like put someone to sleep with a punch.
Mm-hmm.
It's very, very few women, and they're professional fighters, so they know how to throw a punch. They all have trouble hitting the other person, who, yes, is trained, but I guarantee you your assailant probably fights more than you do. So you're very unlikely to have a skill advantage.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a skill advantage, you're not coming to me for advice on this problem.
Right.
So no skill advantage. You probably don't have the weight and the strength as a woman. Maybe you do, but it's statistically, broadly speaking. And, oh, by the way, you have to target that strike. So are you going to hit what you're punching at? Because punching people in a lot of places doesn't really do anything, even if you hit them really hard.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, and they're trying to punch you, too.
Yeah. And you're trying to not be punched.
Huh?
Yeah.
But, like, yes, there's just really good reasons to have skills and tools to get yourself out of there within arm's reach or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But man, like, do you want that to be your best, your only choice or your first choice?
So Annette, where can people find you?
So I am best found through my website, which is onherown.life, or you can go to what is currently my most active channel, which is Facebook, and that's facebook.com/onherownlife, all in one word.
And on the hopeful chance that someone listening wants to volunteer to help you, how would they contact you and say, hey, Annette, I want to be a part of this program. My skills are X, Y, and Z.
So there's two ways for people to help and participate. One is please, please, please read the posts, share the posts, talk about the posts, comment on them. That helps raise my profile, and the larger profile I have, the bigger audience I have, the more resources I have to help people out, because unfortunately we are in the world of social media by the numbers and not by the quality of content. And the other thing is you can DM me through the On Her Own Facebook page.
All right, Annette, thank you very much for coming and telling us about On Her Own. I look forward to seeing how it grows in the future.
Thank you so very much. I'm really, really excited about On Her Own, and I can't wait to see it become a bigger and better thing, not just in my work as I improve what I do, but as others contribute to it.
I really enjoyed this part of the interview, Aaron. It was really good and really interesting. And
well, I think what happened was after the initial awkwardness, because I'm not used to giving interviews and Annette was nervous, after we had talked about On Her Own, we had gotten warmed up and comfortable with each other. And okay, we finished talking about the thing, we can relax. And then it just became banter. And I think that's why it was a lot more natural and really, I don't know if it was more educational, but, well, after we had finished this, I asked Annette, hey, is it okay if we can use this? And she said, absolutely. And in fact, there's a story that's going to end up on a blooper reel.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, there's a lot of good stuff.
And so, yeah, I love the concept of chiding the fact of living in absolute safety. It's the idea of not taking any risks is really just choosing not to live your life. And just cutting productivity. Mike Rowe had a great line saying safety first needs to go. How about safety third? Because there are certain things that are more important, like getting the job done, or is more important than absolute safety. And we mentioned the why women live longer than men, and all the memes of guys doing really, really dumb stuff that could potentially shorten their life for dumb things. Because yeah, there's certain things that you don't want to do. I remember helping somebody break into their own car while I had an active AAA card in my back pocket, and I was I was trimming down a tool so we could get the windowsill apart, and I was cutting towards myself, and I thought I really shouldn't be cutting towards myself. A few hours later, I was out of the ER with stitches.
Oh no.
Yeah. And it was one of those, like, that was just pure stupidity. I said to my friend, hey, he goes, I locked my keys in your car. Can you give me a hand? Yeah, I'll give you a can. I'll call AAA and they'll send a dude over with a Slim Jim and he'll get it open in, you know, in 10 minutes or 10 seconds, really. Take him 10 minutes to get here, 10 seconds to pop it open. Well, no, I think we could do it. It was just boastful pride. That's, you know, that's taking risks that are unnecessary. But, you know, as Annette said, you know, you want to go out on the dating scene. You want to go have a good time. You want to go out to the bars and have a few drinks. You know, if you're going out to the bars and you're having a few drinks, that means you're going to leave your gun at home because you don't want to be drunk and walking around with a gun. It's both illegal and stupid. And you may end up taking a cab or an Uber, which, while there are safety, you know, measures in place for both of those things, there absolutely have been people that have been victimized by cab or ride share people. There are risks that you may get, but at the same time, also do the calculations. Not everyone's getting abducted by a secret killer in a taxi cab. Go live your life. Go have a good time. Go have a few drinks, but don't get so drunk that you're losing your faculties. I liked Annette's philosophy, and I think everyone should adopt it, especially those of us in the self-defense sphere who really think about risk mitigation and sometimes to a fault. Yeah. So another one that actually I really liked, because I hadn't quite gone all the way through, my nephew's girlfriend, I was hanging out with them, and she shows up and she's got her keys clipped to her belt, and on her key ring is one of those little cat ear cestus keychain things. And I told her, I said, don't. That is a bad idea. Like, let's talk about some options that you may have that will be far more effective than that. And, you know, maybe you're not ready for or interested in a firearm. You know, maybe there's some other things that will be better. But man, there's a whole lot of things better than that. And then now to hear about the degloving injury. Ugh, don't Google it. Don't Google it. You can Google it. You will regret doing so. They are awful, awful, horrible, horrible injuries. And to have a tool that you will be using for your quote unquote self-defense that may end up doing that hurt. I mean, there's a better chance of it hurting you than hurting the other person. So that is another just great word to live by. If you have a family member or friend that carries around one of those god awful things, really have a serious talk with them, because again, it's something that will likely hurt them more than the other person if they ever have to use it. And if they ever have to use it, that's a time when they don't want to be playing games like that. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to convince her into some other things. Hopefully I at least dissuaded her from actually using it. But she seems to are carrying it more for a talisman than a legit defensive tool. I've got this option. Will they use it? I've got this thing. Don't do that either.
Magical thinking.
Yeah, exactly.
By the time this podcast drops, it will be Black Friday or later. So David taps into his inner Hank Hill to discuss firearm accessories for holiday gift giving.
Hi, and welcome to Gun Lovers and Other Strangers. With the winter gift-giving holidays quickly approaching, in this segment I'd like to talk to the friends, partners, and spouses of our gun-loving listeners. It can sometimes be challenging to find gifts for the gun lover in your life. Obviously not for everyone or every time, but selecting presents can always have complications. I'm not going to discuss gifting a firearm here, as that should probably be its own segment, mostly to explain some of the legal issues both real and imagined. I'll start by dividing gun lover gifts into two main rough categories, firearm accessories and firearm adjacent items. Though these can overlap somewhat, they're generally defined as follows. Firearm accessories are items that interact directly with a gun, such as ammunition, magazines, optics, gun parts, slings, and holsters. Firearm adjacent items are things that go with guns, but at a different level than the accessories previously mentioned, such as cleaning kits, bench mats, chronographs, eye and ear protection, targets, and reference books. This category also includes decorative items, including but not limited to posters, clothing, and tin signs. Not all of these items will appeal to every gun lover. For example, the cowboy action enthusiast may not appreciate a new red dot optic, just like the ardent 2 or 3 gun competitor may not want a Western-style leather cartridge belt. Gift cards to a favorite website or local store, while less personal, can enable the gun lover to purchase exactly what they want. Another gun lover gift idea is a trip to a firearm museum. I still remember with great fondness the time my girlfriend at the time surprised me with a trip to the Remington Museum in Ilion, New York, which, sadly, currently seems to be closed. Years later, my wife and I made a visit to the Springfield Armory National Historic Site in Massachusetts. There are many museums around the world that either have a firearms exhibit, such as the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City, or specialize in firearm history, like the NRA Firearms Museum in Fairfax, Virginia, or the Cody Firearms Museum at the Buffalo Bill Center of the West in Cody, Wyoming. Since she deals with her gun lover on a daily basis, I asked my wife for her thoughts. She suggested date day at the range, and asking the gun lover to come up with a list of items for the gift giver to choose from. She went on to tell me, if they say you should know or something similar, the relationship is probably doomed. Then she laughed, but I'm not sure if she was joking. Thankfully, I've never done this. There's also the old trick of leaving a catalog lying around and noting which items your gun lover shows the most interest in. Another consideration, just because we're gun lovers doesn't mean we only want gun-related gifts. I'm also a kitchen person, and some of my most treasured presents are for use in that room. Finally, there's the gift made by hand with love, whether gun-related or not. Nothing can top this category. Many years ago, my wife made me a selection of fabric pouches for my handguns for taking to the range or classes. I use them to this day. Happy holidays, and here's to good memories.
Toast to my big brother George, the richest man in town.
That's a Christmas present from a very dear friend of mine.
That about wraps up this segment. If you have any questions for me or suggestions for future segments or a comment on a past segment, please post them on the Assorted Calibers Podcast Facebook or MeWe pages, and Aaron or Weer'd will make sure I get them. I'm also a contributor on the Blue Collar Prepping blog, which can be found at bluecollarprepping.blogspot.com. Finally, I'm also a published author, and books with my stories can be found on Amazon under Brena Bock and David Bock. That's all for now. Thanks for listening. I'm David, and this is Gun Lovers and Other Strangers.
FYI, David's wife is not joking. Mind reading is a huge problem in relationships, and if anything, you should over communicate rather than risk under communicating and just assuming what the other person is thinking, because I mean, assuming makes an ass out of you and me and can lead to some very, very charming marital fights.
So you've got a note here in parentheses saying bookstore magazine story. Mm-hmm. And I shudder at the thought of another Weer'd Beard story.
This is, it's not my story, and so therefore I was not there, so therefore I don't get to tell you what everyone was wearing and how the air smelled that morning and all that. No, but there was somebody I knew was at a bookstore waiting there, and the person ahead of them walked up to the counter and said, "Do you guys have 1911 magazine?" "No, we don't. Do you have Beretta 92 magazine?" And the person said, went over and went, "Can I see that list that you're looking for?" And her husband had written down for, it was right around this time of year. It was holiday season. And she'd asked, what do you want? I said, well, I could go for some 1911 magazines. I could go for some Beretta 92 magazines, because more magazines is always better. And, and she just naturally assumed that, she was talking about periodicals, not about ammunition feeding devices.
So how did the clerk handle it?
I think the clerk was just dumbfounded, and the gunny friend quickly corrected her that she needed to go to a different store to purchase the item she was looking for. Those were not the droids she was looking for.
Okay. You know, if he had just said clips, it would have cleared the whole thing up.
Aaron Paulette.
Give me one of them fully semi-automatic clipazines.
Though, if your loved one does have a clip-fed firearm, having gobs and gobs and gobs of clips is a wonderful problem to have. I have so many SKS clips, and I love it.
You just love them because they're strippers.
I do love them because I really do love strippers in that sense. In the other sense, I don't really much care for it, because I don't want my porn looking back at me. You started this.
Yes, but I'm cute and funny, and you, like your name, make things weird.
I know. Well, I will also say that like David, I love cooking. I mean, obviously, just talking about making salmon and all that. And so, yes, many of my big Christmas gifts and birthday gifts as of recently have been kitchen related. I get a stove for my birthday last year. I'm very happy with that.
A stove?
Yes.
So I'm guessing it's not the full scale kitchen appliance, because that would be an oven.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's the oven stove. Yeah. I interchangeably. Yes.
Oh, okay.
And I understand that Aaron is the prepper, so therefore, yeah, stoves? I got a lot of them.
I mean, I didn't know if it was a camping stove or if it was like some sort of toaster oven-y type stove or what. Mm-hmm. Your relationship to the English language is like second cousins thrice removed.
I am from Maine. Well, you know who's better at English than I am, Aaron?
Everyone!
Oh, there's an ACV film track of that. Oh, one of my favorite movies of all time. Oh, Gary Oldman. Imagine walking through the grocery store and suddenly you hear cut and you realize you were Gary Oldman the whole time. He's that good of an actor. But who's almost as good an actor as Gary Oldman? Say the word. Say the thing.
I mean, the first thing that popped into my mind was Michael Caine, but I actually think Michael Caine is a better actor than Gary Oldman. It's subtle, it's arguable. Well, I mean, okay, Gary Oldman disappears into the role. Michael Caine just plays Michael Caine, really. But he's so magnetic about it that you're okay with it. And so just the whole charisma of, you know, it's like, I'm Michael Caine. And people just, yes, you are, and that's great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and yeah, his ability to be just Michael Caine, and he could go from the, oh yes, I'm a mercenary, I'm an assassin, I'm a tough guy, I'm the most lovable person on the planet. And just, it's one of those, it's all the same Michael Caine, but it works in every single aspect.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not talking about Michael.
Our listeners.
That's right. Our listeners. They're awesome. They are wonderful, and we appreciate. Thank you to each and every one of our listeners. We wouldn't do this without listeners. But a very special thanks to our supporters on Patreon. They help keep the lights on. They keep this show going. And to become a Patreon patron, go to patreon.com/AssortedCalibers podcast to sign up. Patrons get an early release of the podcast, plus bonus content like the hilarious boomer reels, the ACP mag dump, and the ACP film track. I say last because we have Harry Brown is one of our film tracks, and we also have The Professional. So yeah, there we got some really good movies to that you can join us with for the ACP film tracks.
Also, please remember to rate us on Apple Podcasts, subscribe to us on the platform of your choice, and share the show with your friends, both online and off.
I got a blog. It's called weerdworld.com. That's weerdworld.com. And hear me weekly on Handgun Radio on the Firearms Radio Network.
And you can get more from me at linktree.com/AaronPaulette. That's linktree.ee/AaronPaulette, all one word.
And thanks to Nate Spencer for that music.
Damn it, Bobby. That boy ain't right.
And neither is our podcast. Good night, everybody.
Good night. She's not wrong. She is not wrong.